Our first service started at 9 o'clock. We had good attendance, and I thank God for each one of you that are with us today, not only here, but you that are watching from your phones or television sets. Welcome. How many of you have faith in Jesus Christ? Amen. Very good. Today we'll be using scripture from Romans, not only for Joel's service, but also I'll be duplicating that at prayer time as well as during communion. So rather than having opening prayer at this time, I'm going to go right into prayer time. And I apologize. At the first service, I missed a needed prayer that I should have brought up. That is to be in prayer with David and Marjorie Kleiss, Marjorie's brother Paul, son Paul, his wife Rebecca passed away this week from a car accident. Sad, very sad, but we know that she's with God. They had young children, so at this time I'd like to take special note that you be with the DeBilder family and Paul and PJ in Missouri. We also continue our prayer of the virus, COVID. It seems to be resilient, but we know that God is in charge and God will look after us. This coming week, we're going to have Bible school. And we've taken every precaution that we can. We're going to keep the group small. We're going to use as much open space as possible, meet outside. It looks like the week's weather is going to be kinder than this past week, so that'll be a blessing. Then schools open in August. Certainly, God needs to be in control when our kids go back to school. There are 8 to 10 counties in west central Iowa that maybe some of you are aware are in extreme drought. Some of those areas have had less than a tenth of an inch of rain in June and July. And it's easy for us that where our yards are still green to forget that there's such a large section of the state and other parts around the Midwest that haven't received rain. And I can testify to each one of you, 1976, 1983, 1988, and it goes on. They're kind of blazed in your memory. When you don't get rain, you remember those years. It's easy to forget the blessing years, but those years that you don't have rain, it seems to linger for a long time. Were there any others that I missed? If not, I'd like to read from Romans 8:26. In the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. So as we go to pray, let's ask the Holy Spirit for direction. Our dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful at this time that we are able to meet, that we're able to visit with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to do that with a certain amount of feeling of safety, because we know that you're looking over us. We ask that you be with Paul and his family at this time. We ask you be with others that have sadness and heartache. But Lord, at the same time, we ask for rain for those that need the rain, but we give you praise for us that have received it. Lord, you're awesome. You are a wonderful God, and we thank you for that each day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, it's great to see you all. Would you go ahead and stand as we begin to sing this morning?
Come here. tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of praise. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes on you. With steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. And rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. On those with joy his morning sun, and those weeping through the night. On those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never cease. But follow us through all our days with the certain. You use the the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. And so
Oh,
For communion today, I'm going to read from Romans. It's probably a passage that, as far as I know, I have not used before for communion, and I don't know that many have. A little background on Romans. Joel pretty well introduced us to Romans about a month ago, and it's really the center of our worship. The Roman church was actually established by some Jews that were at Pentecost and went by, who passed from Pentecost back to Rome and started the church. And Paul had not been to Rome before, the Roman church before, nor had the apostles. I believe this is true. I wouldn't say it if it wasn't. But I think what's really important about this is, as you read through Romans, it's kind of a resume for Paul. It's kind of his way of introducing not only the Jewish group that were with the church, but the Gentiles as well. And he was introducing to the gospel as Paul not only used it in his life, but as he taught it as well. So I'd like to read from, first of all, a raise of hands of those who have faith in Jesus. Very good. Because righteousness comes through faith in Jesus Christ. And this is from chapter 3, 21 through 25. Now, many times I've heard people speak, and what they speak about is really good, and I really like it. And they get to the end, and you don't get the punchline. You kind of, what happened? I pray that you'll get the punchline on the end of this, because it's really important part of communion. But now a righteousness from God, apart from the law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through the faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified freely by his grace, through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. This is from the law to the gospel. This is why we meet around communion, because now we have faith in Jesus Christ. We know that he died, shed his blood, so that our sins can be forgiven. This is really an important time during our service, when we not only examine ourselves, but we commune not just with Jesus Christ, but also with God and the Holy Spirit, and allow them to enter our lives and have that time for ourselves, our friends in Christ, and with our Lord and Savior. And wasn't that an awesome plan? So let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, I feel so fortunate to be at a time when it should be easier to have faith in Jesus Christ, because it's written, it's presented before us, it's been given to us by the apostles, it's been given to us by the prophets, and by Jesus and Paul. Lord, I thank you that we have this pathway in which we can follow, that we willingly can accept, and that we're freed from sin because of Jesus' death on the cross. And Lord, just to have faith in Jesus Christ and believe in Jesus Christ allows us to follow that path that God wants us to go. These things we're thankful for. In Jesus' name, amen.
passing plates at Madison Church. If you wish to give an offering, there's a plate at the back of the sanctuary and one in each foyer. And as we come to this time for offering in our service, I'd like to read words from 1 Timothy chapter 6. I'm going to start in verse 17. There we read, "Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life." Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Holy Father, help us to put our treasure in the right place. Help us to store up riches in your kingdom, to live our life for the one that we will spend with you in eternity. Dear Holy Father, as we give gifts to the work of your kingdom, help us in our heart to treasure the eternal life we'll spend with you. Praise in your name. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one.
We get to have VBS this week. I'm so excited about that. There was a while where I thought it wasn't going to happen. But here we are. We get to have VBS. This church building and our lawn is going to be filled with kids who are learning about Jesus this week and worshiping with us, and that's going to be so wonderful. And I just could not be more excited about it. Now, a lot of times, well, all the time, after VBS, the Sunday following VBS, we have our kids help lead us in worship. And we might play some songs from VBS. Maybe they'll teach us how to do some actions along with the songs, right? And it's fun to watch you guys, you know, kind of have to act along with them. I enjoy that part. And try to match their enthusiasm on the stage. Now, we're doing, you know, things are different right now. We have two services going on Sunday. So here's what we're going to try to do is our two younger classes at VBS, so the three-year-olds through kindergartners, we'll try to have them come and help us worship in the 9 o'clock service. And the older classes, the first through sixth grade classes, we'll try to have them come and help us worship, help lead us in worship on the 10:30 service. And well, I understand that there are families that have kids that span both those age groups. So in that case, just pick one and you're okay. We can handle a kindergartner at 6:30 and we can handle a sixth grader at 9 o'clock. They'll just be part of it, and it'll be great, and it's just going to be fantastic. Now, VBS is a very exciting time. I don't know if you've been here for VBS, then you know how much energy these kids bring in the morning. At 9 o'clock, they are ready to rock and roll, right? So they are just bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and I think it'll be even more so because they haven't been in school since March, right? So they have some social energy to spend. They're ready, okay? And sometimes getting them to calm down or getting them all directed or a lot of times my job is to tell a lesson or a Bible story at VBS, it kind of feels like a war zone. You guys know what that's like? Trying to get these kids calmed down and do something. It kind of feels like you're going to war. And I actually want to talk about war a little bit this morning, about a kind of war that you've probably heard about or heard people talk about. That is the war over culture. We started to talk about culture here a little bit at Madison Church of Christ because we've been looking at the book of Romans, and specifically we're looking at Romans 12 through 15 that gives us instructions on a new way of life in the Christian faith, a new way to live. And so what that means is that there right now is a culture war in our world. Now, in this war, there aren't any trenches, and there's usually no bombs. But in our world, there are different factions vying to establish their values, their hegemony, their construction of beauty, their projection of ideals, different factions trying to establish these things as dominant in our world and in our society. Now, these conflicts over culture in our world rarely turn kinetic. So they're not like a war in the traditional sense like we'd think of, but that doesn't mean that a battle isn't raging. It is. The battlefront over culture in our world is alive in our country and our state, in each of our towns, our schools and our theaters and the library, everywhere. And shouldn't it be? Shouldn't there be a war over culture? We read together in at the beginning of Romans, Romans chapter 1, God's word telling us that our world's culture is darkened, untethered from righteousness, and pulling the civilization of man away from truth and away from beauty and towards the judgment and wrath of God. Are we not to expect some struggle in our world? Are we not to expect the enlightened believers, those who have received the grace of God, those who have Jesus Christ as their Savior, are we not to expect them to pull in the other direction? Or at least to slow our world's descent into darkness as best as we can? Of course there should be. We should come to expect a culture war. And when it's put that way, it becomes pretty clear that we should be a part of it. Right? If you have been given salvation through Jesus Christ, if your sins have been forgiven and paid for, if you've been given a new life in Jesus, shouldn't you be at war with the darkness of sin in our world? In that kind of war, wouldn't you like to enlist? I want to. Are you with me? But where do we go to sign up for a war like that? Where is the front line in a war on culture? How do we join the fray? That's what I want to talk to you about today, because I think the record needs corrected. I think that we culturally, in the church writ large, have developed a misconception about what the culture war looks like, about what kind of things you have to do to be a part of the culture war. I'm suspicious that when I speak of a culture war, the images that come into your head are like the ones on the screen. You think of demonstrations outside the Supreme Court, public marches past the White House and Capitol building, boycotts of corporations, sports leagues, and media platforms over bathrooms or sexuality or patriotism. You may think of signs with Bible verses held where legislators will see them in Des Moines. That's usually what comes to our mind when we think about a culture war. And I've been to these places. I've marched on Capitol steps with other believers. I've stood with others holding the biggest Jeremiah 1:5 sign we could make. I've even been on the other side of these protests. My senior year of high school, I was on a show choir that wasn't half bad. And if you know me, you know it's some sort of clerical error that I was allowed to be a part of that. But we were asked to sing the national anthem and God Bless America at the inauguration of our newly elected governor in Kansas. And so we were wearing our show choir polos and had our name on them as we approached the Capitol grounds together, and there were protesters who saw us and identified what we were there to do. And they began to holler remarks at us. A couple of them made sure to tell us that we were going to go sing for the devil. And they were just trying to keep our heads down and walk through. Soon enough, they began to chant, "She's the devil," as we walked forward. So you're just a bunch of high schoolers being told we were going to go sing for the devil. It was a different kind of experience. That was the inauguration of Kansas Governor Kathleen Sebelius. Just interesting fact, she would later become the primary author of the Affordable Care Act. But that was my experience on the other side of the protest line. But what I want you to know is that these are not the front lines on a war on culture. If you want to enlist and be a part of the conquering light of Jesus Christ that is at war with the darkness in our world, this is not the front line. Your first station in the cultural war will not be on the Capitol steps or on the sidewalk outside a medical clinic or even on your Facebook posts. Now, I'm not saying that there is no place for these. In fact, when the time comes for them, I'll be there with you, shoulder to shoulder. But if these marches and protests and boycotts have any analog to armed conflict, they are the marginal line. Or Maginot line, so I don't butcher the pronunciation, the Maginot line. The culture war occurs on a much deeper and more personally weighty and threatening level than a once-a-year protest at the Capitol building. And if we don't attend to the true front line in the war for culture in our society, if all or even most of our efforts are focused on the showy or noisy demonstrations where we hold signs, we will be surely and quickly flanked. Culture is more pervasive than this. It is deeper than Supreme Court decisions or legislation. It's more personal than media productions or bathroom signs. Culture has more to do with your heart than what you hear on the radio. Culture is every product of your effort in life and our efforts together. And the front line of the war on culture looks a whole lot more like your kitchen table than the Capitol steps. Last week we began looking in Romans 12, and we'll be returning there today if you want to open with me. Romans 1 through 8 is this incredible presentation of the gospel, this proclamation that we have been redeemed by faith in Jesus Christ because of God's grace, and we have been saved. And it leads to this explanation in chapters 9 through 11 of the role of God's people Israel in this plan and this story of redemption. Well, then in chapter 12, the tenor of the book changes, the angle of the book changes, and it begins to tell us what has to happen to our lives now that the gospel is true for us, now that we have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Last week we read this in chapter 12, starting in verse 1. It says, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." So because of the gospel, because of what Jesus has done for us, we are to be a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. And we can't conform to the way of the world. We can't walk in that same kind of darkness and sinfulness. We have to be different, but we have to be different by the transforming of our mind, by but be transformed by the renewing of our mind, rather. Now, I want you to pay attention as we continue on in Romans 12, as we keep reading. I want you to see how the new pattern of this life is presented, what the first change is, and also we're going to see a connection between this line here, by the renewing of our mind. We're going to see a connection made there as we read forward, starting in verse 3. We read forward, "By the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in according with the faith that God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others." First, I want you to see this clarification that we get here, because in Romans 12, 2, we get this line, don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But that's kind of question begging, because the renewing of our mind is not really clear what that means or what that entails. But just in the very next verse, you're told to change the way that you think about something. Right? Doesn't that seem to maybe apply to the transforming of our mind? In the very next verse, we're told to renew our mind, and then we're told to change the way that we think. The way that we're supposed to change how we think is about our pride and humility. The way that we regard one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. To not think of ourselves more highly than we ought, but to think of ourselves with sober judgment, in according with the faith that God has distributed to each of us. Next, I want you to see this progression from an introduction to about how we should live this new life, to how to reject the pattern of this world and be transformed. It starts with this teaching, starting in verse 3, going to verse 3 through 8. It starts with this teaching about how we are to treat and serve each other in the church. This is the front line of the culture war. When the Bible tells us how to live in response to the gospel, the first thing it tells us is not to march on the Capitol, is not to boycott untruths. It is not to go out to our town and object to and fight against immorality. It's to humbly love and serve each other here in the church. Robert Mounts, in his commentary on this passage, it's the New American Commentary series, he writes, "The Christian faith is essentially a corporate experience. Although each member has come to faith by a separate and individual act of faith, the believing community lives out its Christian experience in fellowship with one another. So even though you come to Christ in faith alone, even though you go down into the baptismal by yourself, if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your faith is something that you do together with others in the body of Christ, the church. It is something that we share, that we walk forward in together as a team, as a body." We learn more about this shared task as we read on in verse 6 of Romans 12. There we read, "We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is and give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, then do it cheerfully." There are all these different kinds of ways that you can serve in the church. And I want you to know that this list is not comprehensive. You don't have to pick one of these. How many is it? Eight? No, six. You don't have to pick one of these six things. It's not just one out of the six. In fact, throughout the New Testament, there are, depending on how you count, either 17 or 18 spiritual gifts listed in the New Testament. Ones that don't appear in this list include administration, evangelism, discernment, wisdom. Okay, the list goes on. This is not a comprehensive list where you can only pick one, or a list where you have to pick from one of these. But it's just a way of saying that there are all kinds of different ways that you can serve in the church, that you can serve the body of believers. There are different things for you to do and different ways that you have been given by God. As Paul says right here in Romans 3, as a grace given to me. Okay, different ways that you've been given by grace by God to serve his people, to do ministry among the brothers and sisters here at Madison Church of Christ. There are different things that you've been given, and then the point of this passage is not about listing all the possibilities that you can serve, but saying that if God has given you this opportunity to serve, then get to work. Right? Each opportunity for service here listed in this verse, it is coupled with an imperative to get to work, to start using it, to do it. This passage is about putting our faith to work within the church, for each other, in humble and loving service among the body of the church. And the spiritual gifts are not a prison. They shouldn't be seen as a limiting factor for your service in God's kingdom. You may have things that you're more naturally prone to do or you feel most comfortable doing. Maybe on this list, you feel most comfortable with the gift of mercy. And you are just great at showing empathy and communicating to people your love when they're having a hard time. But that doesn't mean that it's the only way you can serve in the church, that if another need arises which you see in Christ's body to serve, but it isn't mercy, that you shouldn't do it. Okay? Loving Christ's church and serving it will often mean seeing a job that you don't particularly feel comfortable doing or wouldn't naturally want to do on your own and doing it because you love Christ. And because Christ has poured out his humble love to you, and you're willing to take the bullet. You're willing to do the dirty job. This last week, I was at a church camp on the Nebraska-Iowa border called Neboa. And so my job there was to speak. So I spoke at chapel, and I also did a morning show, which means I made kids play very gross games. And I don't know, maybe we could start doing some of those in the church service. What do you guys think about that? Cody and Jake didn't see the kick shoot. Nobody here can tell you about any of the gross games I've done at church camp, which is good. It'll be a surprise. So that was my job. That was what I brought to camp to do, right? But I ended up doing other kinds of things that week. I didn't just speak. There are opportunities for me every minute of every day to serve and love on these kids who I was there with. But one that sticks out to me is just because of the way this camp is set up, everybody stays in one big giant dorm. There's a boys' side and a girls' side. But on the boys' side, there's 70 junior high schoolers here this week. The boys' side is just one big communal bathroom. Okay? And this particular age of children did not really take ownership with how they treated or left those facilities. And sometimes things would end up in the facilities that they would put things in the bowl that shouldn't be there. And we were talking about frequent clogs and floods. And I spent a lot of time last week with a plunger and a mop. Okay? And it's just, I didn't go to church camp to use a plunger, but that's what I spent a lot of time doing. It doesn't mean my spiritual gift is plunging, because it's not. Okay? My spiritual gift is digging dirt. It's not plunging, but that's why you can't see spiritual gifts as a prison or something that you have to wait to do until the area that you're gifted comes up for service, and then all of a sudden you're tapped into the game. Serving Christ's kingdom means seeing the need among God's people, seeing an opportunity for you to humble yourself or give from what you have or share from the time that you have to love God's people and meet their needs. And sometimes it might be telling them the gospel, and those are great times. Sometimes it might be plunging toilets. Those are great times too. Any service that we do in God's kingdom is love that we're sharing among each other. And it is how we fight the culture war. I told you that in the pictures I showed before, that I've been to those places. I've marched at the state capitol. But I did more to fight a war on culture last week with a plunger, than I did marching on a Capitol building. And so too will you, when you see an opportunity to serve a brother and sister in Christ here in this church body, when you see an opportunity to serve a kid in our congregation, a young person, one of our nursing home residents, when you have an opportunity to give somebody a ride or to be generous to someone who needs it here in our church body, that is how you fight the culture war. That is the game plan that God has laid out before us. You see, God's word lays out a blueprint or a battle plan for the culture war that is different than the way that we're used to thinking of it. We are used to thinking of a culture war as being those kinds of marches or we might think of a culture war as something we fight on a Tuesday in November. But culture wars start with the transforming of our mind. Don't be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then, when we address that battle line that runs in our own heart and our own mind, we begin to work and serve in our roles in our family. This is not a topic that's addressed here in the passage of Romans that we're covering in this series, but is one addressed a number of times in the New Testament. As we get three different household codes that give instructions to fathers, to mothers, to husbands, wives, and to children. We have this passage. I want to quote to you from 1 Timothy 5:4. It says, "But if a widow has children or grandchildren, these should learn first of all to put their religion into practice by caring for their own family and so repaying their parents and grandparents, for this is pleasing to God." This is specifically an instruction for widows. But you can see this line here. They need to put their religion into practice by caring for their own family. We fight the culture war at our kitchen table. When we're serving there, we're ready to serve in Christ's body. This is what our passage is about today. That's what Romans 3-8 cover. That's why we're told that in this new life, the one that rejects the darkness of the world and has been transformed by Jesus Christ, the way that we fight in this new battle is to serve each other humbly in love, to be a servant for each other. In Galatians 6, it's talking about service, and it says, "Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people." Then it says, "especially to those who belong to the family of believers." Our gifts, our efforts in Christ's kingdom are to focus on each other in the church. And it is when we do this, when we serve and love one another, that our world will see and be changed by the light of Jesus Christ. And so many times we can be caught trying to shortcut this battle plan, to shortcut this outline given to us in God's word. And we can skip transforming our mind. We can skip loving and serving and teaching our family. We can skip serving each other in the church. And we want to go straight to changing our world. Right? Because you see things out there, you see things on television, you watch things in the news that anger you and that you know that are displeasing to God, things that are going on in our world, and you want to get out there and do something about it. But God has had a plan from eternity to reveal his manifest wisdom to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms through the church, God's plan for how we wage a culture war, for how our world sees and accepts the light of Jesus Christ, is through the love and service that we provide to each other here in this room, in the body of Christ, in our church. We conquer the world by humbly serving each other. God's word tells us that this will work. Do you believe it? When you see the news and you think the world is headed in a pretty bad direction, when you watch media that is filled with evil or wickedness that is designed to lead people away from righteousness and the truth of God's word, and you want to do something about it, God's word tells us that the way we do it is by loving and serving each other in the church. That by doing that, the world will see the light of Jesus Christ, and God's word promises us that it will work. That it will work. It doesn't promise that marching on the Capitol building will work. It promises us that serving and loving each other humbly in the church will work, will reveal his glory to the world. This is, after all, the way of humility that Jesus Christ showed us. Jesus himself, being God, came to the earth to become man, to go through all the pains and the imperfections and the struggles and hurt of human life, all the loss that we experience here, to suffer a cruel and painful death. He humbled himself in that way to serve us. And by doing so, he set an example for us to follow as his church. He showed us how to change the world by humbling ourselves and serving each other. We read a passage from Philippians 2 about that. It says, Philippians 2, verse 1, "Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, any common sharing in the Spirit, any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, rather in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, because he did this, because he took this path of service, it says, therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father." Jesus' death and crucifixion fundamentally changed the way the world worked. All of a sudden, there was a way open for us to be restored to God's presence, to be freed from condemnation in God's sight. That's what Jesus did for us on the cross and over the grave. But do you know why the Church of Jesus Christ had the power and persistence to proclaim this gospel until their death? Do you know why the gospel had the compressed energy to spring across the world at breakneck speed? Do you know why this gospel persisted through millennia and has reached us here in Powashik County, Iowa? Because Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Because Jesus taught his followers a way of humble service, where their energy is directed not against a quixotic charging at windmills or marching on Capitol buildings, but their attention, our energy is spent on serving and loving one another in Christ's body. That's what gives the engine of the church the compression it needs to propel the gospel forward, to show the world the light of Christ. It is the way that we love and serve each other in the church. So if you would like to join the culture war, if you see the world around us and know that it is dark and you want to do something about it, then humble yourself and serve God's people. Find ways to love and give to the people in this room, to lift them up, to be their friends and their partners. That is how we fight a war on culture. That's how the world will see the light of Jesus Christ. Together in this room, we are on the front line of a culture war. Jesus changed the world by washing his disciples' feet. Will you follow in his steps? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you and give you praise for all the service and love you have poured into my life through the church, through my faithful brothers and sisters and mentors in the faith who have given so generously to teach me your word, to lift me up when I was down, to encourage me. Dear God, I pray for each person in this room that they will also, in the same manner, be recipients of that grace. That grace that we get to offer each other. And dear Heavenly Father, as we see the darkness and sinfulness of our world, I pray that we will become agents of this love and this service to each other. That we will take up the task that we have been given to love the body of believers so that the world may see your light, so that we may change subversively and persistently the darkness of our world through the way that we treat each other and through the service that we offer to one another. Dear Heavenly Father, fill our spirits with the resolve to do just that. I pray this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand as we close today?
You are not alone if you are lonely. When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same in need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh,
people say
the people said, amen.